Hey guys, I'm going to do an update on my Panther in Poland diorama that I'm working on. What have I done? I haven't done any more work on the figures. They still need more detail painting and stuff like that. I basically just stuck them in their positions so I could talk about what I'm working on. The two buildings I've done quite a bit of work on. Firstly, one of the buildings has arrived. That's the one that Ian White, also known as Shocky, also known as CW Modeling on YouTube, he sent me. I'm going to move this so you can actually see it better and then zoom in. Cause some of you guys may have actually seen it on Facebook. I don't know if Ian's actually put it on YouTube or not, but that's the house or shed that Ian made. And it's superb work. Ian's a hell of a craftsman. I mean, I've seen the pictures of the thing and I thought it was quite cool. Then I saw it up close sitting here in front of me. And it's really not very often I get to see another modeler's work up close, like tangible, like I can actually touch it and like look at it and reverse engineer it. it's very rare. I see it, the only other time I ever see it is at my local hobby show. And, you know, you can't pick them up and handle them and stuff like that, of course. That would be ridiculous. But it's the closest I can get to someone else's work. And, you know, there's a wide selection of people's work and stuff like that. But a lot of it is not exactly my style. It's not my genre, or it's, you know, it's not where I'm going with where I'd like to take my skills. Ian's, however, is in that realm. And so looking at how he did his work, Ian's a far better painter than I am, and his access to products is better than mine. So from the picture that I had of that of this shed, I did what I could to make my house look similar. It's not exact. I mean, there are differences. The color on mine is different, and some of the material that's used on the roof is different. But there are similarities between the two of them. Now, when Ian's shed arrived and I sat the two of them down, there were significant differences. I could tell I needed to work on mine to do some blending. I didn't want to do anything to Ian's. Actually, I did one thing. I put a back on it. Ian's didn't have a back on his. So I put a back on so that it's similar to the back that's on mine. I'm going to paint that so that the two of them are the same. But I needed a false back on there so that it wasn't just open foam board. It had nothing to do with Ian's work or anything like that. But it also allowed me to see what it was he used for the, you know, construction, how he put the thing together. So. But I do enjoy looking at how Ian put that thing together. And I got to see some details that I actually couldn't see from any of the photographs, like how he did the construction of that little awning that's over the door. You know, exactly how that's done. It's very different than mine. And the reason is because I couldn't see all his. But now I know how he did it, and I really like how he did it. And now I know how he used his oil paints, and how he did his moss, and how he did his mildew stains, and stuff, the green stuff that you see on the roof and everything is mildew. And he used a texture putty, a texture paste from, I think it was might have been Vallejo, one of the mud pastes or something like that that he used to do the roof, where I used cellulite to do mine. The effect is very similar. So the effect is actually thinner. The dirt on my roof is a bit thicker because I use cellulite. And he used slightly different coloring on the grass, where mine is more alive. His is a bit more drought stricken, I think. The coloring of the wood is different on Ian's than it is on mine. His is more bleached and more pale looking than mine. And the reason for that is because, well, Ian was going for a much more weathered, aged look than I was. I was going for one as well, but not quite as aged as Ian. Now, when I originally conceived of this scene, I didn't originally plan to have my own house. I was going to use Ian's because he had already said he was going to donate it. But then I thought, I'll build my own too, and try and blend the two of them together. So I wanted to see if I could do it. It was quite the challenge, too. Now, it's like I said, it's not exactly the same. And once Ian's arrived, there were some features on there that I wanted to add on here. So there was, he has some yellow lichens growing on his that I didn't have on mine. So I added those to mine. I don't, the green moss that he has growing on his, I don't have that color of tuft, turf, what's it called? Accent turf, or I can't remember what it's called. It comes from Woodland Scenic. I have the same stuff, but mine's a different color. And the algae, or not the algae, the mildew that he did on there, I don't have the same color. So I have to restain mine on the roof to make it a bit of a darker color. That's no big deal. So the timbers, his are more weathered than mine, and they're a more faded color than mine. Mine looks newer than his. But that's kind of what I wanted, because that's supposed to be a utility shed, and this is supposed to be the actual home. It's supposed to be a newer building and better maintained and more domestic. And that's supposed to be, you know, more for tools and farm implements, and maybe even animals are kept in the back and stuff like that. So there's enough, after I did more, I did a lot more oil work on this, trying to fade the wood more, adding much more gray and much more whites to it, and adding a lot more stain to the boards where the joins are and stuff like that, to try and get a more equivalent age, to age this more, so it's closer to that. It was much newer looking. I think I've gotten it, it's as close as I can conceivably take it. I'm worried if I do any more to it, it'll mess it up. I don't want to push it any further than it is. It's one of those things where, you know, you keep doing the less is more. You do a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more, and then you get it to a point where you go, if I go one more step, it might be too far. So that's where I stopped. I'm worried if I go one more layer at what I was doing. It's kind of hard to go halfway than what I was doing. If I go one more thing, it'll be too far. So I just stopped it. I said, that's as far as I'm going to go. The base itself is done. I had to build up underneath, so I added a layer of DAS on there just to build up so that I had something for the house to sit on so it's level with the ground. Did the same thing with Ian's house. I didn't bother doing anything for where Ian's shack is, because I didn't know exactly the shape and dimensions that Ian's was going to be. So I had to wait for it to arrive before I could do it. I had to actually chisel out the cellulite clay and remove a whole corner in order to do that. That was an effort, because cellulite clay dries rock hard, like super rock hard. And it's, you can chisel it and you can remove it and stuff like that, but it's a bit of an effort. It doesn't come quietly. You can do it, but it's a bit of work. Like, you can sand it and you can reshape it to a point and stuff like that, but it's pretty tough stuff. But you want it to be, right? You want it to be pretty tough. For a little while, I had to clamp this thing down because I used MDF, which I really got to stop using. I used MDF as the base, and the cellulite clay started to curl it, so I had to clamp it down for a couple of days, and I re-wetted the center. I basically added water along the middle, so it laid back down again, let that dry for a few days, so the curl ended up going away. There's still a little tiny bit on the edges, but I'm not going to worry about that. It's flat enough now that it doesn't look like it did. It was going pretty much banana boat for a little bit. And then I decided that it's time to start the tree. I was going to originally just start working on the diorama base itself, like putting the grass on, well, paint it and then put the grass on and everything. But then I thought, oh, no, let's do the tree first. So I started working on that. The tree was an interesting experiment. It's a pretty simple thing. If I can get it out of here. It's not attached or anything. It's just sitting in its hole. There's not much to it. It's literally just a dowel, a wooden dowel. It's actually one of the dowels I was using for the Hurtgen Forest diorama for place marking. So I took a wooden dowel and I wrapped the bottom part of it to make it thicker in wire, so it looked like it was wrapped in a spring. And then I drilled a bunch of holes all the way through, going all the way up, and I threaded some other wire going through, made loops, and twisted them up so they're nice and thick and rigid, and I could shape branches. So I did that all the way up, right up to the very top. And the dowel itself, I tapered it a bit. I just took a knife and chiseled it down so it was more like a spear than anything else. And then I sanded it a bit. And then I drilled those holes and I stuck the wires through. CA glued them in place so they wouldn't move. Shaped them so that they're kind of like sticking up like that. And then let the CA glue dry for a little bit. And then I pulled out some DAS, just the DAS air dry modeling clay. Got a bunch of it here, I'll show you. In case anybody doesn't know what it is. Comes in different colors, white and terracotta. That's it there. It's basically modeling clay that dries rock hard in the air. You can accelerate that with a heat gun, which is what I did. I cheated. Instead of it taking like a day or two to dry, I had it dry in about an hour with a heat gun. I put on a pair of rubber gloves and I tear off pieces of the DAS and I squish it out flat. I get it wet first and then I squish it out flat. And then I layered it on all the way up, out on the branches and everything all the way up. And then when I had it all completely coated in the DAS, I took a brush. Where are they? In here. I took a brush like this and I dragged it down the trunk, basically making a bark texture, right? All the way around, I did the branches and I did the trunk and everything. And then I took it and I whacked it on the branch, on the trunk as well, to make like a stippled type effect. Not everywhere, just in places. And then I took kind of a flat scoopy tool, if I can find it. First I'll never find there, that one. I used that and I carved out a couple of knots in the thing. I doubt you'll be able to see them. Around the side there, and there. There's pictures of the tree on my Facebook page, so you can look at it up close there. I carved a couple of knots in it, and then that was it, basically. I let it dry. I didn't let it dry. I hit it with the heat gun and dried the thing. It took about an hour, and I could handle it. Like I could, you know, manipulate it and stuff like that. So while it was still a little bit soft, because it wasn't completely hard, I poked a bunch of holes in all the branches, and I started adding pieces of seafoam. That's what the smaller branches are all made out of. So I had all kinds of the seafoam already cut out and ready to go, and it was all spread out. And I take a little pool of CA glue, the thick CA glue that I use, that Bob Smith Industry stuff that I like. And I dipped the seafoam in it and I stick it in the hole. And I just went up and down all the branches, started at the bottom, working my way up, making a big ball of tree. So it's big and tree-like. Now, you got to remember, this is the first time I ever did anything quite like this. I've never done anything this. I've never done a tree like this before. It's new to me. I've done something similar a couple of times. Mostly it's pine. But I've never done a deciduous tree like this. So it was an interesting experiment. So once I got the seafoam in, I let the CA dry, the CA glue dry for about 20 minutes or so. Don't really need to let it dry that long, but it was mostly to let the CA glue and the area around the CA glue, that's the part of the clay, bond together, right? And then once that was dry, I hit it with the heat gun again, and did that for about 20 minutes, I guess. I hit it with the heat gun, and then after that, I primed it, and then I painted it a couple of different shades of gray and some browns and some olive greens, the whole thing. I waited for that to dry, and then I dry brushed pretty much all of the main branches in the trunk with a couple of different colors of gray. And then I detail painted the knots, and then that was it. Waited for that to dry overnight, and then I came back with some of the accent stuff. It's what we use from the moss. It's what's on the house here. It's like the moss here and then there. And I took, I have some thin PVA in an old Walther's Solvacet bottle, and I brush it on, and then I take a paintbrush and I pick up some of the moss. I'll show it to you here. I just recently ordered some more. It looks like finely crushed foam. You can see that. Right? Looks like finely crushed foam. And I literally just pick it up with a paintbrush and I sprinkle it. Like I tap the paintbrush and it falls into the glue and sticks. And I use that and I texture it all over the tree trunk. So it's like moss growing on a tree trunk. You can do the same thing with sawdust. Very finely ground sawdust, which I also have here. But you'd have to paint the sawdust, unless you're using like using it to do it like a yellow lichen or something like that, which looks cool too. I'll use pigments a lot of the time for yellow lichens because lichens are pretty small. Then that was it. Once that was done, I couldn't handle the tree anymore without damaging it, so I had to handle it by the bottom. I took it and I stuck it in a vase. This. And actually, you can see where it was, and started adding the leaves. The leaves is basically two different colors of super leaf, which is a product that I use off and on. I also make it myself, but when I make it, it's much more fine ground, and I tend to use that for different products. I tend to use that for like a moss or lichens and stuff like that. It's basically sawdust that's tinted with paint, so it's colored. But I use two different colors. And then I actually added some birch seed in with it to give it the yellow colors that are in there. So I mixed it all together and I sprayed, I turned the tree upside down and started spraying the bottom first. And I started sprinkling the super leaf all over the branches. I'd spray it with hairspray and added super leaf. And I spray it with hairspray and it does two things. It allows me to add a second layer, but it also seals in the first layer. And then, you know, I keep turning it and turning it and turning it, do it, and then I turn it on its side, do it from the sides, all the way around, right, adding the super leaf, adding the super leaf, and then I do it from the top, same thing, all the way around. So it's a big ball of, you got to be careful, you got to try not to get too much of it on the trunk. Now, I got some on the trunk, but there's no way I'm going to get it off now, it's too late, but, again, it's my first time doing this. I'll know next time to be more careful with the hairspray, be more careful with how I'm sprinkling it and stuff, or make the ball impenetrable so I can't see inside where it's the leaves have actually fallen through and stuck to the trunk. I could probably scrape them off, maybe, but I've already sealed it with a flat coat right now, so it's not coming off now. Too late now. Next time. So anyway, so that's how pretty much I built that up. Then once I had everything all on there with the hairspray, I went back over it with, this is an eyeglasses or lens cleaner stuff that I fill with PVA. You always got to shake it up, right? And I sprayed that all over the tree, basically sealing it all in with glue, so it's all nice and tough. And then to take care of any shine from the hairspray, that ended up developing like mostly on the trunk and stuff like that. I sprayed it again with a matte coat. It also would seal it in even more, but also get rid of any shine that's on the tree. So, and that's that. So it's ready to go on the diorama, but first I have to paint the base in its base colors, and then I have to start adding static grass and tufts and small bushes and that sort of thing. So there's still quite a bit of work to do yet. But the major parts are finished, and it's just basically the diorama part itself, which I don't think is going to take too long. I don't think. I'm still considering adding a couple of figures walking past here in the foreground. It looks a little naked here, but I might actually, instead of adding figures going by, I might actually replace this with a shrub wall or maybe some taller grass. I'm not really sure yet. So, and I'm not really sure if I'm going to keep the two asses. You might be able to see them. They're under the tree. I might get rid of the asses altogether. They don't seem to fit anymore. At first I thought it was a good idea, but my two asses need to find a new home. I might put them on the Soviet diorama, which is over there. I don't know if you can see it. That's still under construction, but that's the next video. Anyway, you guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now.